Good morning, Gateway Church. Let's stand and let's sing some songs this morning. Put our hands together. We are free in Christ this morning. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. To all who are the tired and the heavy laden, hope has come. To all who feel the weight of a broken spirit, hope has come. Lift up your eyes, lift up your head, the power of our sin is dead. We have won, death is swallowed up in victory. Through the sun, the grave has not succeeded in its grip over me. Those who seek the love of a perfect Father, hope has come. To those who seek the light of the risen Savior, hope has come. Lift up your eyes, lift up your head, the power of our sin is dead. He has won.
Try that again. How are we doing, Gateway Church? There we go. So excited to be with you. You're at the 10:30 experience here at Gateway Church. We're at three services now. Who here is excited that we're at three services now? Come on. So good. We have such an awesome experience planned for you today. I'm glad that you made it out. Listen, if you have any kids, I just want to go ahead and invite you again. There's an awesome kids program. It's safe. It's exciting. It's awesome. Feel free to check your kids in over there at any point throughout the service. As well, there's a middle school program that happens during the talking portion of this service. And so you'll see something pop up on the screen over there. That's when you're going to get sent out to your kids, grade 6 to 8. They're going to have a lot of fun with Pastor Eric and his team. As well, also want to point out, we just made a new prayer room. It's just off to the corner on the other side of this wall. So if you just step out through that back door over there, take two quick lefts and go down that hallway. If you need anybody to pray with you, talk with, maybe give you a hug, anything along those lines, that's the room for you. As well, if you look back there, there's a blue wall. It says connect on it. all the information about Gateway Church, whether it's how to get involved, what's happening, maybe you want to join a Connect group, because Connect groups, that's where it's at. That's where all that information is for you. Well, again, if you're new here, we're glad that you made it. We're glad that you trusted us with a portion of your morning. And so we actually have a gift because you did that. So if you step into the atrium after this experience, feel free to go over there. We have an awesome gift for you. Okay. I've talked too much. I'm tired of my own voice. I want to hear some of your voices. And so I'm going to give you 5 minutes. 5 minutes. You're going to say hi to 5 new people. Sound good? 5 new people. We'll be back in just a moment.
Waking. Well, good morning. So good to have you all with us here today. I'd love to see you enjoying one another's company. Again, if you're a guest with us, welcome to Gateway. My name is Rick. I'm one of the pastors here. And we're so excited to have you with us here today. We have just a couple of things to share with you today. First of all, normally this is about when we have our offering. There are a variety of ways in which you can give. We love to give because God has given to us, and so practicing generosity is one of the ways in which we worship God. And you can give today. You can give online, by envelope, phone, or debit. A variety of ways in which you can give. Normally, we would have ushers, and they kind of pass the plate, but by going to three services, we're not doing that anymore. And so there is a giving area right out back by the reception, and if you came with an envelope or you'd like to put an envelope and put a check or something in there, you're welcome to do that. Someone will guide you. We've got a little turnstile. You can see a picture of it right back there, and that will be where you will put your offering in at the end of the service or anytime throughout the service. So we just thank you again. When you're generous, you allow us to be generous and to give here in the city of London. As well, coming up next weekend, we have one exciting thing that's coming up. We have our spring market on May the 4th. It's a way in which we support the London Support Center, and it is going to be just a great, great weekend. It's a Saturday, 9 till noon. We have all kinds of vendors, all kinds of fun things, and we know that there'll be hundreds of people here. You'll want to come and check it out. It's kind of a come and go thing from 9 until 2 p.m. You'll want to take advantage of it. It's going to be an awesome, awesome Saturday, so don't forget to put that on your calendar. I'm excited about our message. I'll begin a brand new series. I'm so looking forward in just a few minutes to sharing that with you, but let's worship him right now.
Let's stand together and let's just continue to sing.
Me out of darkness, you have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Yes, Lord, I can't help but see. Yes. Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that your love is unconditional this morning. There's nothing that can separate us from it. Nothing that we can do to lessen it, Lord.
Come on.
that the highest King would welcome.
Come on, let's sing this.
I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Who the sun sets free. Oh, it's free.
I am chosen, I'm not forsaken, no, I am
Maybe you've been mistreated in the name of religion, or maybe you've just never had any use for it. Maybe you've heard things like, you're a sinner, so God doesn't love you, or you have to change if you want to join us. Maybe that's why you dropped out of church, or never went in the first place, because it seemed completely irrelevant to you. Or maybe it was even worse, like, you're not good enough, or we don't want you. So you just said, I don't want anything to do with it. I don't blame you. But you want to know the truth? Jesus extended an invitation to every single kind of person imaginable. Being a sinner or a skeptic or an unbeliever doesn't disqualify you. It doesn't matter how little faith you have. Regardless of what you believe, regardless of how you behave, you are invited to follow.
Well, we're excited today about this brand new series, as you've just saw it, called Follow. We're pretty excited about this, and I want to thank you all for coming. Those of you who are joining us here today at our main campus, or if you are at one of our other campuses, if you're streaming online, good to have you with us here, joining with us today. If you're watching this and it's later on in the week and you're on a treadmill, don't stop, keep going. You're getting in shape. Love to hear about it. Every time this year we do a church-wide campaign along with the series right after Easter, we do it in a way that hopefully you will invite your friends and your neighbors and those who perhaps maybe used to go to church and don't go to church anymore, or kind of went to church and kind of invite them back, or those maybe who've never heard about church. We also encourage people to get into connect groups. We provide questions for you to continue the conversation that we're going to raise over these next 8 Sundays. Doing something else special at the end of this series, or at the end of this message today, at the very end, we're going to have an open mic dialogue, so that as I'm carrying on this message right now, if there is a question that comes up into your mind, Pastor Tim is back there at the sound booth. You can go back there, you can give him a question, or I'll ask you random, and if you want, you can raise your question right at the end of this service. We'll take about 5 minutes, and anything that I cause you to kind of go, what do you mean by that? We can talk about that right at the end of today's service. Okay, let's go. So I grew up in the church, and my whole life, and in the church, we had this thing called church ease. How many know what church ease is? Church ease is the language of the church, and you kind of have to learn the language of the church, and if you know church ease, then you know what I'm talking about. If you don't know, don't worry about it, but it's a little bit like going to Starbucks. I love going to Starbucks, but I really don't like ordering at Starbucks. I know it sounds kind of weird because I never know what to order. I look at all the drinks and look at all the things, and I get so nervous, I get all worked up, and I just go, coffee, just give me coffee. But I like to go with somebody who like knows the language, because like I'm not bilingual, Cheryl's bilingual, so I will often go to Starbucks and I'll actually sit back, and there's a guy driving the car, but Cheryl's there, and when the person comes and asks what they want, I just go, tell him. So she'll actually order the coffee for me, and then they're always surprised because it's a man driving and not the female voice that asked for the coffee. But I get all worked up with all that thing because I don't understand the language. There's a language in the church, and we call it church ease, and especially as Pentecostals, growing up in a Pentecostal church, I'll tell you, there was a language to what we had, and it was always centered on feelings. It was always about feelings. It was always subjective in nature, and we used phrases like, I just sense in my spirit. I just feel in my spirit. I'm just sensing this in my spirit. I don't sense this in my spirit. I'm going to know what I'm talking about. And you're like I feel God or I don't feel God. And you know what? There was anointing or there was a touch on that song today. And there was just something that was going on. And who are you going to argue with? Like, I mean, like you would never go, you know what? God was not on that song at all. That was just awful. Or you know what? The pastor, there was no anointing on him today. Like you can't touch that. You know, we sang songs about, you know, like the touch of feeling the brush of angels' wings, and we feel these angels' wings, and I don't really know about it. And please understand, I'm not making fun of any of this. I really do believe that there's a sensing of God's spirit. I believe that we need to have more of that, and so I'm all for this. I believe in all this, well, except maybe the angel wings, not so sure about that, but it's just that we get so used to the words that we use, and if you're on the inside and you understand the words, then you understand what we're getting at. But if you don't understand the churchies, if you don't understand the words, you hardly even know what you're talking about. And we just start to sound a little bit weird. We talked a lot about growing up as a kid. We talked a lot about grieving the spirit. And apparently I was guilty of that. I grieved the spirit a lot, or so I was reminded of and told. And I, looking back on it now, I know it was just a way to guilt me into proper behavior. It was just a kind of way, but I misbehaved a lot. So, you know, the pastor would ask everybody to bow their heads, and I had taken the church bulletin, and I had made it into a paper airplane, and so when all the heads were bowed just before he said amen, I'd shoot a plane out over the audience, and so you see the plane cascading as everybody lifted their heads to say amen. You know, I used to go into the church kitchen during the service or whatever, and I would drink all the communion juice, and that's a true story. Yeah, I'm pretty sure it bought me a one-way ticket to you know where, nursery duty. You know, all of those kinds of things. But my point about all of this is that if we're not careful with the language, if we're not careful with the approach, we can get a little bit weird. And a little bit weird, we become a little bit cynical, and then after a while you become a little bit cynical, you become a little bit critical, and that's why I believe many people have left the church, because we got a little bit weird, and then we got a little bit cynical, and then we get a little bit critical, and we do what we do, and we don't do what we don't do, and we never explain the why. Why do we do these kinds of things? And growing up in the Christian church, I kind of felt like my whole spirituality was this giant game of Jesus says. Jesus says. You know, you all played Simon Says? Well, I grew up thinking that it was Jesus Says, and I don't know where I got this, but it's kind of like, you know, Jesus says, go to church. And you know, Dad, why are we going to church? I don't know. Son, just shut up. We'll go to church, because that's what we do. We go to church. Jesus says, go to church. Jesus says, pray. Jesus says, don't look at that. Jesus says, don't watch that. Jesus says, don't touch that. Don't touch that. Gotcha. I mean, that's kind of what it was for me. And then as I got older, I saw that other people were playing the Jesus Says game, but they weren't playing the game right. Because in our church, we played it right. In other churches, they weren't playing it right. And so we kind of judged the other churches because they were playing Jesus Says, but they were playing a different game. And as I got a little bit older than that, I began to really not like the way I played Jesus Says, because they played Jesus Says and they got to do a whole lot of things that I wasn't allowed to do. And I didn't like the way they played Jesus Says, or at least then I started to hate the way I played Jesus Says, and it just got so confusing. And later on, I began to realize that I wasn't playing Jesus Says very well myself. And so I kind of walked away from the church and fell away for a little bit because, you know what, I just didn't seem to get it. And here's what we're missing. Here's the whole point. We missed it back then, and I'm not sure that some churches are maybe doing it better. We're trying to do it better here at Gateway Church. But if you start with a blank slate, if you start with just Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, if I were to give you that part of the Bible and say, that's all there is, if you were to read that, the one thing that you would come to conclusion with, hopefully you would, is that the gospel of Jesus Christ is extraordinarily relational. If there's any one thing that we need to come back to and to begin to remind ourselves, that the gospel of Jesus is about a relationship with Jesus Christ. Jesus said, if you know me, you know the Father. I have come, I have incarnated, and I have come to dwell on this earth so that you would know what the Father is like. If you know the Father, you know me. If you know me, you know the Father, and all of those kinds of things. Because it's all about a relationship with the risen Savior, Jesus Christ. And the tragedy is that when we lose sight of the relational nature of Christianity, when we begin to pursue the things that we're supposed to do and not the things we're not supposed to do, we lose. We lose focus. We lose our joy. We lose our victory over temptation. Some of you are struggling with things in your life right now, and you've been struggling with them for a long, long time. And the reason why you're struggling and not getting any victory over them, because you're focusing on all the things you're supposed to do and all the things you're not supposed to do, and not focusing on Jesus himself. And if we were just to put Jesus back into the center of everything that we do, we'd have a better understanding, and I think we'd find our joy again. It's kind of like pursuing the principles and the rules of marriage and forgetting the fact that you actually have a relationship with that actual person. And Jesus came to lay the groundwork for a new kind of relationship with God. And he gave us all kinds of word pictures. He gave us the idea of that a father and a child. And that growing up, I thought I knew my dad. And when I was 5 years old, I could tell you all about my dad. And I knew my dad, and my dad was the best dad in the whole wide world. And then all of a sudden, I turned 25, and I realized that, you know what, 20s, you know, my dad wasn't the best dad in the whole wide world. And I knew him more then. I didn't kind of like what I knew that I thought I knew when he was 5. And now I'm 55, and he's 76 and 77. And I know my dad better now than I did. And the idea that there's a progression of understanding, and that you may think you know God now, and then you didn't know God, and now you do know God, and you're trying to figure that all out. But there's a process of maturing in the relationship with God, like there's a process in the maturing of a relationship with Jesus. And Jesus went on to talk about the fact that he is a vine and that we're the branches and that we have to stay connected to the vine, and that when we stay connected to the vine, the Bible talks about abiding. When we abide in the vine, then he remains in us and he feeds us. He goes on to talk about the fact that he uses the shepherd and the sheep metaphor, the picture, the voice, if you would, that I know my sheep and they know my voice and they follow and when I speak. And all of these things are used to describe our relationship. And that's really what we want you to understand as we begin this series.
And we're simply calling it follow, because everything comes back to that one invitation of Jesus Christ that he extended not just to the 12 disciples, but he extended it to rich people and poor people, people that were spiritual and unspiritual, religious and irreligious, to sinners and all the like. Jesus said this, simply follow me. Now we're going to look today in the book of Matthew. Matthew is one of the writers. He's the first writer in the New Testament. And he's telling his story of his recollection of all of his experience with Jesus. And one of the things that he does in chapter 9 is that he begins to tell about how he met Jesus. And it begins simply like this. Jesus went on from there and he comes to this man named Matthew who's sitting at the tax collector's booth. Now, by way of some of the background, we're going to do some background information here today. We've talked about this before. Jewish tax collectors were the most hated of all people. So to set the context, when it says that Matthew was a tax collector, it means that Matthew was the most hated man on earth. They were considered the scum. The Romans imposed taxes, all kinds of taxes, and property taxes, and income taxes, and taxes on roads and bridges and gates and harbors and towns. And we always think, you know, it says, and Jesus and the disciples were kind of walking along, and you see pictures of the Holy Land, and you think, well, they're just walking along all these paths. You don't understand that every so many miles and every so many feet, there was somebody there to tax them, and you had to pay so much money to stay on the road, and if you didn't pay the money, you couldn't stay in the road, and you'd have to go off into the mountains, and you'd have to crawl through rocks and snakes and all kinds of things. Every single road, you had to pay to be on those roads. And so taxes were a constant reminder of Roman oppression and occupation. Some things never change, I guess. Jesus finds Matthew sitting at the Roman custom house on this highway, and he's a social outcast. And we can almost read the minds of the apostles because they were with him. So there's Peter and Andrew, James and John. They're already there. And Jesus walks up to Matthew, and I don't know if he was paying to be on the road, but he walks up and he begins this conversation. And the rest of the disciples that are with Jesus, you know what? They either sneer him or they fear him. They've had a run-in with him. There's no doubt they knew him. They would have crossed his path on many occasions and probably have paid him. They surely would have hated this man. And Jesus walks up to him and he makes all kinds of comments, you know, like, you should be ashamed of yourself, or how are you taxing these people, or there's a great sarcasm, your mama ought to be proud of you, and all things. No, he doesn't do any of those things. Jesus walks up and he has this incredible conversation with him, and all he says is, follow me. He looks him in the eye and he says, Matthew, follow me. Now, here's where you got to get some background of the story, and you just got to hang with me on this. Jesus was a rabbi, and in our culture, especially for us North Americans, when we read the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we read it from our perspective, not a Jewish perspective. We're Gentiles. And so we know that Jesus was a rabbi, but we don't focus on what that actually meant. This invitation to follow was far more than just if a rabbi said, you know what, hey, why don't you take some time off work and follow me for a while, and I'm gonna show you a few things. No. This was an invitation to become part of his following, which made Matthew a candidate to be part of the inner circle. So the Jewish people believed that God had spoken and that his words had been recorded through the books of Moses. So it would be Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, the five books. We call them the Pentateuch today. Back then, the Jews, they call it the Torah. And the Torah means teaching or instructions. And they believed that the best way to live and to please God was to obey and to know the Torah. Follow the rules and you please God. And so the Torah was so important that they made it a priority to teach every single child. And so there were three schools that every child was invited to attend. Now, they would begin these schools, but they wouldn't necessarily finish them because they were very, very difficult and challenging. The first school was called the House of the Book, and it began around age 8. And here in the House of the Book, every child was expected to memorize the Torah, all of it. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, all of it, backwards, forwards, upside down, memorize it all. And if they did that, and they did that well, they moved from age 8 to what was called the House of Learning. Somewhere between the ages of 13 or 14, they would move on to the House of Learning if they could, and they would then study the Psalms, Lamentations, all of the artistic books of the middle part of the Old Testament, all of the major prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and they would memorize it so that by the age 14, 15, it was not uncommon for a child, if they had finished school number 2 or house number 2, that they will have memorized the entire Old Testament. And your kids are whining now about their math and their English. By then, they would have memorized the entire Old Testament. Now, if they passed those two schools, there was a third school, and if they had a really good understanding, and they were very, very keen and sharp, they would move on to what was called the House of Study. And only by invitation would a child be invited to go into the house of study, because they were considered the most holy, the most knowledgeable, and the best chance to become a rabbi themselves. And they would continue to apply oral and written law from the Talmud, the Mishnah, the sages, and years of commentary over hundreds of years. They would study the actual scrolls. And one of the sages of the Mishnah quotes and used this phrase, "May you be covered in the dust of your rabbi." Understand that a rabbi would invite those who would follow him, and they would just go through the countryside, and he would begin to talk, and they would discuss the rules and the regulations and the person of God. And as he would walk, he would kick up dust. And as the dust would get kicked up, it would flow backward onto the disciples. And they come to the end of the day, and their feet were dirty, and they would have to wash their feet. And as they would wash their feet, they would be reminded that they were covered in the dirt or the dust of the rabbi. And so it was an incredible thing for you to hear the phrase, "May you be covered in the dust of your rabbi." It was such an honor. By the way, the rabbi's interpretation of the rules of the law, you know what it was called? The rabbi's understanding of the rules and the way he saw it was called his yoke. Does that sound familiar to anybody? What was Jesus? Jesus was a rabbi. And what does Jesus say in another portion of Scripture? He says, "Take my yoke upon you, for my burden is light." What was Jesus saying? Remember, whenever you read the New Testament, Jesus never threw words away. Every word is loaded. And so Jesus was actually saying, "My yoke, my understanding of the law, my understanding of the rules of the regulation, my burden is light. I am not about the rules. I am not about an endless list of regulations. I'm not about the do's and the don'ts." When he said, "Take my yoke upon you," he was saying, "It is not about the words. I want a relationship with you." And so he was not just picking those words out of the air. So what about everybody else? What about those who didn't go to school number one or school number two? If you didn't have what it take to please God, if you didn't have what it take to memorize all of those laws, what happened to you? You went back to your family. You went back and picked up on the job of your parents. So if your dad was a farmer, you were a farmer. If your dad was a fisherman, you were a fisherman. If baker or shepherds, that's why you have Peter and James and John and all those other ones. They were fishermen. They had gone back because as a child, with all of the pressure to keep up and all the pressure to measure up and all the effort to be graded and to please God, they failed. And so if you failed, you went back and picked up the family business. Now, what's the point of all of this? My point is just this. Matthew was a Jew. Do you understand today? Matthew would have gone to school number one, for sure. Matthew might have even gone to school number two, but it's obvious that Matthew's a dropout. Matthew's a failure. And on more than just a failure to the schools, but Matthew's not good enough to even take up the family business because Matthew is a tax collector. And Jesus looks at him and says, "Follow me. I choose you." Do you understand today that Matthew, when he got up and says, "I will follow you," Jesus didn't say, "If you're willing to do this and this and this, then I want you to follow me. Or if you stop doing this, I want you to follow me. Or you know what? We'll just kind of work this through, but you got to do all that. You got to change all these things." No. Jesus says to Matthew, "Follow me." The same invitation that Jesus extended to the Gospels to all kinds of people is the same message that he extends to you and I today. Even though you don't make the cut, even though you're a screw up, even though you're a failure, even though you and I both know that there's sin and there's things going on in your life that if I were to lay it out right now, you'd be so embarrassed you'd never want to come back. It doesn't matter where you are or what you've done. The same command to Matthew is the same command to each and every one of us to follow him. And why is that so significant? Because the symbol of Christianity is a cross, not a scale. The symbol of our Christian faith is a cross, not a scale. So you may not think you make the grade, but Jesus says to each and every one of us, follow him. The simple invitation is the most accurate picture of what the Christian life is all about. And so the only question that you must answer over these next 8 weeks is, am I a follower of Jesus Christ? Now, back to Matthew. This invitation is not sitting well, all right? It's not going well. And then, the disciples are like, okay, we were at a tax collector's booth, and now we're at the tax collector's house. We're going there for supper. Are you kidding me? Like, didn't we just do the whole Zacchaeus thing? Like, wasn't that enough, Jesus? Do we have to go to another one? And I'm sure Peter was like, yeah, I'm not going to his house. It's got tax collector cooties or something. Like, there's no, I'm not going in there. I can just picture, you know, another one of the disciples, Jesus, I just got a bad sense in my spirit. Jesus, we just can't go in there. You know what, if there's angels' wings flapping around in there, it's got to be from the wrong angel in the wrong place. But we're not going back in there. And look what happens. It says, while Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house and all the disciples are in there, here's what it says. While Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate. Many tax collectors and sinners came and ate. Can you imagine? I would have just loved this. I would have given anything to see the look on the disciples' faces. It's not enough that we're here to have supper with him, but he invites all of his friends. And the place is now full. Talk about tax collector cooties. They're all in there. And tax collectors that are friends of tax collectors, if they don't have friends that are tax collectors, then the only thing they have left that's worse than a tax collector is a sinner. Now, we don't know what kind of a sin those sinners were sinning, but they were like worse than a tax collector. So we're talking not little sins. We're talking big time sin stuff. I can almost see, you know, one of the sinners sitting there eating, and the disciples look at him and goes, what are you looking at? At least I'm not a tax collector. I mean, it was just awful. And it's important that you understand all this, because this is why it's a really big deal. If you're new to Christianity, or you're left, or you're not sure you're going to stay, and you're kind of wondering, and maybe you used to go to church, and you're not anymore because somebody judged you, and somebody kicked you out, or you felt like you were kicked out, or you were not welcomed, and whatever your deal is, what I'm about to say to you is so extraordinarily important. Jesus was so comfortable with people who were not like him. He spent most of his time with drunkards and with prostitutes and with tax collectors and with sinners. Jesus was extraordinarily comfortable with people who were not like him. And everywhere you look at the gospel, you will find that people that were not like Jesus were extraordinarily comfortable with him too. And when Jesus saw this, they asked the disciples, or the Pharisees saw this, it says in verse 11, they asked the disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? So the Pharisees are kind of outside. They wouldn't dare go into that building because they were like too holy. But they're kind of looking inside and they're going like, okay, he's a rabbi and he's a holy man and we're holy men and he's a law keeper, we're a law keeper, and you know, we worship God and he worshiped gods, and like so why is it that we have so much in common and he didn't invite us? Why would he choose people he's nothing like instead of the people that he's all like? And I don't even think he really likes us, and we don't really like him, and we're not sure about that. Jesus hears the rumblings outside and somehow it gets back to him. And Jesus says, it's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. Go tell them this. It's not the healthy that need a doctor, but the sick. Now, I hear Jesus saying that to them out there, but what makes me pause is, what does Matthew think? Jesus says this phrase out loud. Go tell the Pharisees that it's not the healthy that need somebody, it's the sick. And Matthew's like, what'd you say? Like, you're in my house. You're eating my food. And by the way, it's not cheap food. And you're calling me sick? You're here in front of mom and my friends, and you're saying you're here because we're sick? Like, really? Now, I don't know how it went down, but I think Jesus kind of turns him and says, excuse me? You're a tax collector. You're hurting your own people for your own profit. That's sick, Matthew. That's sick. Now, before you go judging Matthew, who of us are any different? How many of you are consistent with your own rules and your own regulations? Moms and dads, how many of you are imposing rules and regulations on your children that you're not even keeping up yourself? Hey, Dad, how about all those things that you're asking your son to do that you're not doing? Or at workplace, where you invite all your employees, or you have this expectation of what should be done in the workplace, but you're not doing them yourself. You see, if there is a God, you've broken his rules. You have to admit it. I have to admit it. If there is a standard in you with Jesus and you fall short of it, you've got to come to grips with the fact that you cannot follow the rules good enough. And Jesus goes on to say in verse 13, but go and learn what this means. Now, this is so offensive. Again, we just pass this by. But Jesus says to the Pharisees, go and learn what this means. Now remember, who are the Pharisees and the Sadducees? They've gone to school number one, school number two, school number three. They're the most learned of the learned. And Jesus, a rabbi, tells them, you guys need to go and learn. Obviously, you guys haven't learned enough. Obviously, you guys don't make the grade. You guys haven't figured this out. And it's so offensive because they were so good at being good, and they knew good, and they described good, and they controlled good, and they measured everybody else's goodness. And their time and their job was being good. And Jesus says, you don't understand. You need to go and learn this. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I have not come to call the righteous, but I have come to call the sinners. In other words, I'm not simply content to be with people who believe all the right things and do all the right things. I want to be with people who do the right things and believe the right things so that we can have a relationship with those people who don't do the right things and don't believe the right things so that they can learn how to believe those right things and do those right things. Which is why I describe Gateway as a hospital and not a hotel. And the one of the desires that we have in the leadership here is that we want you to understand that Gateway is a hospital, not a hotel. We dare not become a church that is so content to gather together and to believe all the right things and to behave all the right things and then not to do anything with it. Because if we do that, then we'll be the ones who are standing on the outside looking in where Jesus is dining with the tax collectors and with the sinners. So Jesus says, follow me. But let me warn you, if you follow him for very long, one of these days you're going to look in the mirror and you're not going to know who you are. You're not going to realize who you are because being a sinner does not disqualify you. It's a prerequisite. You may never thought of this before, but Jesus only invited sinners to follow him. And he invited them to believe and to follow him before they ever got better or before they ever committed to doing so. That you can belong before you can believe. And it's one of the things that we believe here, that you can have a relationship in the community at Gateway before you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's okay. Tax collectors are welcome, and sinners are welcome, and you are welcome, and you are welcome, and you are welcome to come and to learn what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ. And the more conscious that I am of the work of God that is yet to be done in me, that I am less critical of the work of God that has to be done in you. Because when you stop following, you start judging. When I'm in follow mode, I am so aware of what I need to become. But when I stop following Jesus, then I start judging everybody else around me. So the question that you and I, at the end of the day, is not where you are in your journey, is not how good you are, it's not whether or not you know the language or the nomenclature of the churches. The only question that you and I have to answer is, am I following Jesus? Let's pray. I pray that you are following today. If you haven't, you can decide. You can choose today to say, you know what? I want to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Maybe for the very first time, you will come to that place where you'll say, today I take a step. Today, I want to be a follower of him. I haven't got it all figured out. I know I'm a screw up. I know I there's some things that I don't want anybody to know about, but today I want to afresh affirm that I want to be a follower of Jesus Christ. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Okay, questions, comments. Come on, that had to stir something up. Somebody's got a question here for me. What do we got? No hands. Anybody gone back to Pastor Tim? You got anything for me there? Nothing. Nobody has it. I was awesome. Like, wow. No questions. Oh, there's a question. It's Wayne. What?
Everything you've described is great in theory.
Yep.
What practical steps is Gateway doing to actually ensure that people are welcome?
Absolutely. That's a great question. So he says, that's great in theory, but what steps would we as a church be taking to make sure that everybody is welcome? We're in the process right now of retooling a lot of the way in which we do church that we're going to be kind of transforming over the course of the entire summer, really hoping to present something that'll be really, really fresh in order to help people find a way to follow him in a way that kind of, not that we're trying to lower the bar, but we're trying to open the door. We're trying to make sure that the door is big enough. And we really want to make sure that we have a big enough door so that everybody is able to find their way into the place. Because I believe that when you know the Jesus that we know, that you would not want to follow him. If you knew the Jesus that we know as we read him in the New Testament, why wouldn't you want to be a follower of him? Because he's the most wonderful person in the whole wide world, and he's absolutely changed and transformed my life. So why wouldn't you want to follow him? So it's a question of inclusivity that we are working on and wanting to create. And it's one of the reasons why we do this series. For those of you who've been around and you go, why do we always seem to be landing on this idea and this conversation? Because our Sunday experiences are meant to provide open doors for people. We believe that church happens in connect groups. Church happens in home groups. That's where you study. That's where you get your commentaries out. That's where you really get into it. And we want you to get into it. But here on our experiences on the weekend, we want it to be so that you can invite anybody to come in and they'll go, maybe I'll give Jesus another try. And so hopefully that's what we're trying to accomplish. If we don't have any questions, here's a question I have. Here's a comment for you. We do have a question? Okay, now we got questions. Okay, go ahead. Oh, absolutely. I kind of alluded. How do I know when I've stopped following Jesus? I'll tell you, one of the number one ways that you know that you've stopped following Jesus is when you start judging everybody else for how they're not following Jesus. The number one way that you can know, hey, I'm really not following Jesus, is when your eyes get off that track and you start looking at everybody else who's failing. And when people go, oh, the church is full of hypocrites, and I've left the church because they're full of hypocrites, and then, you know what? Look in the mirror. Look in the mirror. Because the person who says the church is full of the hypocrites, that person is probably the greatest hypocrite of them all. If we keep our eyes focused on following Jesus, then our only concern is one thing. I want to honor him, please him, and I want to get to know him for everything that he is in my life. And if I do that well, then I will stay following. But if I'm starting judging others, then I'm in trouble. We're going to do Q&A every Sunday and throughout these next 8 weeks, so there's more to come. Charles closes off.
Well, thank you so much, Pastor Rick. Hey, listen, if you made a decision today and you said that I've taken a step in your spiritual journey, I just want to go ahead and encourage you to tell somebody. Don't leave it to yourself. Don't keep it to yourself. Again, there's a prayer room right off to the corner over here. Please go in there, and people would love to talk, chat, pray, give you a hug as well. The pastors will be out there. They'd love to hear all about it. As well, in the atrium, you probably would have seen it as you walked in, but there's a bake sale. And I love bake sales. And there's nothing better than a bake sale that goes to a good cause. And so GSM, Gateway Student Movement, come on now. There you are. Gateway Student Movement, they're doing a bake sale for a conference called Overflow. Overflow Conference. There we go. And so essentially what Overflow Conference is a bunch of students come together, I think it's over 3,000 students, come together into an arena, and they say, you know what, today, this weekend, I'm going to devote my attention, my time to Jesus. And I don't think I've ever left an Overflow conference not changed. And so what this bake sale is for is that all the money that is fundraised here, it allows the students of GSM to invite a friend for free, to invite a friend for free. And so I don't know about you, I love sugar, but if I have to pay for sugar, I want it to go to a good cause. And so there's awesome stuff out there. I've been eating and snacking away through the middle of the services. Please go out there. Eric and the team will be there to help you guys out as well. Next week, May 5th, there's an event. It's called We Are Worshippers. We Are Worshippers is essentially an event where it allows a bunch of different churches within the city to come here and simply say, you know what, we're going to put our differences aside and we're just going to focus on Jesus and we're just going to lift the name of Jesus up high. And so I want to invite you to that next week. It's on a Sunday. You're going to want to come a little bit early. I believe the event starts at 6:30. So maybe try and aim to be here for 6 if you want a good spot. My last thing is there's a Connect Corner, like I already mentioned before. That's where all the information about Gateway Church. And so if you've been here for a while, you said, you know what, I'm ready to take a step. I want to start serving. I want to start to be a part of what's happening here at Gateway Church. All the information is there. Well, that's all I have for you again. Thank you so much for being a part of this service. I'm trusting that you're leaving encouraged and inspired. We hope to see you next week.